Welcome to Ideas in Action, the official University of Southern California podcast. This show was recorded live on USC's campus.
So I guess let's just start with a quick introduction. Are you from Texas originally? Is that where you are from? And then what brought you to Los Angeles?
Yeah, I'm originally from a little place called Lubbock, Texas. It's about more north Texas, close to Amarillo, about 5 hours from Dallas. I say that because a lot of people don't really know where Lubbock is. So I was born and raised there. I attended college and medical school there, and then decided I really wanted to try and experience a new world for myself. I did a way rotation here at USC during my fourth year of medical school, and really, really enjoyed myself, really connected with people here and the world here. And so during the match process, I ranked USC and I matched here. So I decided to stay and stay on as faculty after my residency.
Wow. I guess LA does have a little bit of a pull, doesn't it? It's a pretty fantastic place to live, but also it sounds like USC had its own charms for you. I noticed you're wearing a shirt that says Sojourner. Can you tell me a little bit about that? Oh, I see. It's more than that. Okay.
Yes. So this is giving homage to Black History Month, which in my opinion, every month is Black History Month. So, and speaking about LA, you know, I think that especially in reproductive health, I think, you know, when we talk about access to care for women in general and abortion and care for African-American Latinx women, care for LGBTQ patient population, I think California is very unique in really leading the way for providing this care for our patients who belong to underserved population. So that was a huge reason why I decided to stay in California, especially as I am an OBGYN, and these topics of reproductive justice, social justice are extremely important to our specialty and how we practice. So,
you know, I've read your biography that's posted to the Keck Medicine site, and I'm curious because you mentioned that growing up as a biracial child prepared you in some ways to serve your diverse patients. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yes. So I am biracial. My dad is African-American. My mom is Mexican-American. And growing up biracial, specifically growing up biracial in Texas, was a very interesting experience. As I said, Lubbock was a very conservative town. It was a very segregated town. It still is, unfortunately. And so growing up biracial, I was really able to really experience different worlds on a daily basis. So as I said, my mom is Mexican-American. So growing up, she had her culture, she had her beliefs that usually were very different from my father's. Opposites do attract. I really do believe in that. And so I was able to grow up in a household where there were immense difference of opinions, right? On a variety of topics, right? What is our religion? What foods do we like? Who are our friends? Like, there were so many experiences that my parents had differing views on, which I, looking back, was actually very beneficial, because I think it really allowed me and my brother to be open to different possibilities, different opinions, different perspectives, and to really gain empathy for other people, which is why I thought medicine would be, you know, the best specialty for me. But also being biracial also was challenging as well. I think that growing up with identities that could go a lot of different ways, you can grow up a bit confused and a bit excluded, right? Am I not Black enough to be with the Black kids? Am I not Mexican enough to be with the Mexican kids? Or who are my friends? Where do I actually fit in? So that was a very unique challenge that I experienced growing up. But ultimately, I think it really gave me the tools to really be adaptable and flexible to different personality types, being able to meet people where they are, being empathetic, and really listening and valuing other people's opinions rather than, you know, thinking that my way was the best way, or, you know, my way is the right way. So I really gained a lot of people skills and life lessons just from being biracial, which I carry on in practice, you know, bring into my practice every day with my patients.
And how do you use that experience and your other expertise that you've gained along the way to help your patients feel heard, especially if, you know, they're not feeling heard in other aspects of their lives or their medical care because of racism or gender bias or, you know, other things?
Yeah. So implicit bias is huge. Microaggressions are huge. Medical gaslighting is huge, where patients simply come to providers and are unfortunately getting dismissed, getting stereotyped, getting judged, and not receiving the adequate treatment and care that every person should get. And so this is especially prevalent in women, LGBTQ patients, African-American, Latinx, and it's unfortunately resulting in disparities in healthcare that we see so prevalent, especially after COVID. So I think that it's the number one tool that I bring, which is very simple, is just to listen, right? I think that it's very, unfortunately, very rare for patients to come in and actually get listened to. I think that there's a huge rush in the clinics and there's a huge rush for reimbursement and there's a lot of time constraints for providers, and that's a whole challenge by itself, but it really creates barriers from providers to actually listen to their patients and really give them time to explain their story. Because honestly, 90% of us creating a diagnosis is based on the patient's experience. And so I really do my best to ensure, you know, 20, 40 minute, even an hour patient visits are appropriate, so that I have adequate time to really get to know the patient, establish a nice trust with them, especially in OBGYN. We do very sensitive exams, probably the most invasive exam a woman can ever experience. And we talk about extremely intimate, personal, vulnerable experiences and situations. There are some stories that my patients have never told anyone else, and I'm the only one that knows that, right? That's a very huge blessing and honor that I you know, look at my patients for. So I think it's really important that we set time aside to just listen to my patient. I just allow them to speak, you know, what brings you here and how can I help you? Not interrupting. These are very simple things, right? But unfortunately, it's very easy to miss when you go visit a doctor, right? So listening, not interrupting, and equally important, validating them. So I think it's really important to not only listen, but listen with a very empathetic voice, right? Making sure that patients understand that they are heard and that their experiences are valid, even if their experience is very, very different from what I've ever experienced myself, or their beliefs are totally different from what I believe in, right? Or, you know, their religion is totally different. Like, it really does not matter. As a provider, I welcome patients to really come as they are. We have a sign in our office, like, come as you are, because honestly, I truly believe that it's provider skill to adapt and meet their patients' needs. It shouldn't be the other way around, where patients have to adapt to a doctor's mood or a doctor's way of doing things or a doctor's preference, right? It should be totally the opposite way. So listening, validating them, offering them tips. So a lot of our patients come with really bad experiences from other doctors, diagnoses unfortunately being missed. Sometimes they come because they feel very comfortable with us and tell us stories about the current doctors that they're seeing in other specialties and how to navigate those experiences. And so it's really important just to be honest with patients coming from a patient perspective and also as a provider perspective too. So really giving practical action items for patients to take is another thing that I do. So, and then asking, how can I help you? How can I be a part of making sure that you are getting what you need from the medical system? So
that seems like a really fantastic list for any medical provider who's seeing patients. I guess that's what they mean by bedside manner. So tell me a little bit about what you mean by medical gaslighting and some examples you've seen of that in patients who've come to you.
Yeah, so gaslighting in general is essentially a person invalidating or negating another person's experience or reality. So for example, a person gaslighting another may say things like, I didn't say that, that actually never happened. Or you're extremely sensitive. Why are you making this a big deal, right? Essentially invalidating someone else's experiences and feelings. It is a form of emotional and psychological abuse. But unfortunately, it happens very quickly and it's very subtle. So there's not really time for someone to learn about it or actually put a label to this action, right? And it's so common and prevalent and affecting so many people. But in medical gaslighting, it's the same sort of terminology, but instead providers are basically invalidating patient experiences. So a very common example that we have in OBGYN is pelvic pain. So many women go to either their primary care physicians or internal medicine or OBGYNs reporting pelvic pain, or my periods are really painful. And a lot of that is really met with a lot of resistance, everyone's periods are painful. That's not a big deal. You don't have to worry about that. That's just natural. You know, that just happens to everyone, right? And so unfortunately, with that sort of mindset, a sort of dismissal, patients unfortunately are not getting diagnosed for serious pelvic pathology that could be present, like endometriosis or uterine fibroids or ovarian cysts, right? So that's a very common example that we hear, unfortunately, from our patients on a daily basis, where, you know, I've gone to see two or three doctors. I've been told the same thing. There's nothing wrong with me, but I feel that there is something wrong with my body. Can you help me? And that eventually leads to workup, appropriate workup, and actually finding, well, you indeed have endometriosis, and or you indeed have a large fibroid that has been creating a mass effect in your body, causing all of these symptoms, right? So medical gaslighting is huge. I think it's affecting women for sure, even on a higher level, women of color. Again, our patients are transgender patients who identify as women. It's a huge topic that needs to get more attention because I think it is just so common and prevalent. And there are ways to navigate that. You know, I think it's important for patients to know what this term is, to know exactly what to look out for. And I think it's equally important, if not more important, for providers to learn about this because our patients know about this now. And it's extremely important that we as providers never want a patient to feel like they are being gaslit. So I think education for residents, students, faculty at the hospital level is crucial to continue this important work.
Talk about what it means to serve transgender patients and provide trans-affirming care. I know that is one of your specialties.
Yeah, I think serving transgender patients, it really exemplifies how humans should treat other humans, right? I think that transgender patients are probably one of the most underserved patient populations, right? Constantly getting dismissed from providers, constantly having providers that don't understand them, that don't understand their condition, that doesn't understand the unique risk factors that they have, the disparities that exist in their patient population because of this lack of knowledge, right? And unfortunately, providers who don't adapt to make a patient feel comfortable, no matter who they are, right? And so I think providing transgender care, it should not be as rare as it is. But unfortunately, at this moment in time, a transgender patient cannot just walk into any clinic and receive the care that he, she, or they deserve, right? And so to be in a position to be able to provide that care is extremely rewarding. It's very humbling too, because I think that being a provider for transgender patients, a skill you have to practice is honestly cultural humility. I think it's really important to, you know, enter this work as a very humble individual, not wanting to learn from your patients, to truly learn from your patients, because ultimately the patients are the experts of their body. And, you know, we just happen to go to med school and read a textbook and know how to diagnose things, right? But we're actually working together to come and see what's best for this human being, right? And so I think that, you know, being able to provide that in our clinic is very unique, is very special. We take it very seriously because unfortunately it's not available as wide as it should be. So it's a extremely gratifying experience, and we're constantly looking to get better, constantly looking, how do we improve our clinic? How do we improve the care? How do we eliminate these disparities? What can we do as providers and as a practice and as an institution, right? So I think it's never being complacent with where we are, always pushing the bar to ensure that, you know, our patients receive the care they deserve.
And speaking of pushing the bar, you've said you have a passion for using virtual platforms and social media to educate your patients. That seems like a pretty new path for a lot of healthcare providers. So tell me a little bit about the upside of these tools and some ways you've used them.
Well, I love social media. I love Instagram. I have yet to get a TikTok. The younger generation keeps telling me I need to get a TikTok, so I'm going to get one soon. But Instagram is my primary use of social media, and I think it's huge just because we're able to reach so many people with social media that we were not able to do in the past. I also think that in terms of education for residents, students, patients, you know, the time of like giving lectures, that's dead. Lectures, reading textbooks, it was nice. It did its job. But I think the younger generation, they're used to a different way of learning. It's really more about engagement and interaction and learning the whys behind things rather than learning just random facts and putting them together. So I think social media is a way that we can really teach in the way that our society currently is moving towards, right? Videos, pictures, memes, reels. I also love social media just because it allows one to just be so creative. It actually is a wellness outlet for me. Like, I really love creating content because it's fun to do. It allows me to really express myself. It allows me to show people, show patients that doctors are humans too, that, well, my doctor has an Instagram and I see what her life is like. Like, that's really cool for me to be able to share with people, because I think that this hierarchy of, you know, physician and patient is very toxic. It's a very toxic setup, and it always has been. And I really want to, you know, put down that barrier, because, you know, growing up, I never saw a doctor that looked like me, not one time. I never read in books doctors, you know, I never saw images of doctors that look like me. And that's really hard growing up, knowing that you want to be a doctor, knowing that that's your passion, but you have no sort of example on even how to do that. And so I think now social media is really creating ways for the younger generation to see, wow, my doctor actually is a human being. And I actually relate to her. Like, we came from the same place, or we like the same foods, or we look the same way. Our hair is the same, right? And it really gives hope and inspiration to those who really need it, especially, you know, underrepresented students. Like I said, I never saw anyone that looked like me. If I had Instagram back then, I probably would have felt more hopeful and felt more confident in navigating this journey, right? Because I saw someone that did it too. So I hope that social media provides that venue, not only for education, but just inspiration for, you know, our patients to see us, for our students and our young generation to see us and see that it's possible. And really feel connected to medicine. I think social media is all about connecting people. There are negatives to that. It can be too much connection, too much fake superficial connection. Totally get that. But it's connection. And I think if you do it and use it the right way, it can be extremely powerful.
It's very interesting hearing you talk about you know, the fact that you never saw anyone who looked like you who was a doctor when you were growing up. And now it seems like you've got the opportunity to be a role model for young girls of color who are interested in pursuing a medical career or career in medicine. And obviously one of the reasons we're talking today is because it's Women's History Month. So I'm curious about who your women role models were when you were a kid, who inspired you? And what are some ways that women healthcare providers are, you know, making history right now?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think that the way that women providers are making history now is that we are making our presence known. We are actually becoming doctors. And so a couple of stats that I wanted to share. So recently, the AAMC, which is a huge medical corporation that reviews statistics and provides guidance for, you know, the medical profession. Their 2019 report just showed staggering numbers in terms of females actually being the majority of U.S. medical school students. So women are now 50.5% composition of medical schools. That's huge. That's the first time that women have ever, you know, been the dominant group in medical school representation. So I think that's really showing that we're moving toward this trend of more equity and more inclusion in medicine, more representation, which is great. On the provider, practicing provider side, men are still the dominant group. Specifically, white men are still the dominant physician, practicing physician group in America. However, when you really analyze the younger cohort of active physicians, so those 34 years or older, women are outnumbering men in most racial and ethnic groups. So again, we're seeing this trend of women really standing up and really learning that we can be doctors too. And not only doctors, we can be amazing physicians, right? And we have very special things to offer that probably have not been offered before, and really getting the support to actually make it happen. So I'm very hopeful to see those numbers. I hope they continue to go in this wave, but it gives me hope. And I think, you know, that's really making history right now. In addition to all of the accomplishments that women physicians are doing, you know, so that gives me hope. I'm kind of in a zone where I'm being super inspired by young Black women who are standing strong against social justice, anti-racism, social equity. Those women give me life. So there's two women that are actually just, they're my women crushes right now. They are amazing, Rachel Cargill and Elaine Welter Roth. So Rachel Cargill is actually an African-American author, speaker, and activist. She founded the Loveland Foundation, which is actually a foundation that provides free therapy for girls and women of color. So no matter what your background is, no matter what you do, no matter how much money you make, you can get free mental therapy at no cost, right? And so that's huge to me, because I think that mental health has drastically been overlooked. And I think now we're starting to see how important mental health is, specifically for women of color. And so for her to raise money for that and provide this service to all women of America, I think is amazing. And that really motivates me. Elaine Welter Roth is, she's a journalist, editor, author. She was the she was editor-in-chief of Teen Vogue in 2016, and that made her the second person of color to be editor-in-chief in all of Vogue history, which is huge. And she was young when she did that. She was in her 20s, 30s, right? So to see very strong young women that I can relate to, again, it's just very huge for me. And anytime I need a pickup, right, I watch their videos. And again, YouTube, social media, I can connect with them, right? It's not this weird, like, just see them on TV or read about them in the news, right? Like, I can actually connect with people that inspire me. That's huge. And so shout out to those two women. They're amazing. I really hope I get to meet them one day. But everyone should check their work out. It's very powerful.
Well, thank you for sharing that, because those are two names that maybe our audiences are not as familiar with. So I think it's terrific. One of the great things about women's history is it's being made right now. So you have these contemporaries who, you know, listeners can check out and learn more about.
Yeah.
Returning for a minute to your day to day, you've mentioned a little bit about what's rewarding about your work, but if you could just say the one thing that's the most rewarding about the work that you do, what is that?
The most rewarding would be to really be there for my patients and see what an impact that we can make for their lives. I think that we have so many patients who travel miles to see us simply because of the unique talents, skills, representation that our office brings. And to be able to provide that service and actually meet amazing people from all over California, all over the United States to come see us and to provide the care and to see that, you know, whether they cry or they have a sigh of relief or they're smiling of joy, like they are actually heard probably for the first time. That's extremely rewarding for me. That really keeps me going every day, despite the, you know, bureaucracy and politics of medicine and academic medicine. And, you know, that is really, you know, what keeps me remembering why I'm doing this. Why am I here? So my patients, they give me life. They literally give me life and energy. Also the residents and students. So whenever I'm able to teach them something, maybe something they knew, but in a different way, or something that they will literally take with them the rest of their careers, that's extremely rewarding for me, because I feel that I can actually be a part of supporting them, advocating for them, to see what magic and inspiration they bring to the world. So it's this constant cycle of learning and giving back and inspiring and supporting others. Like it's a wonderful tool that we have here in medicine, that, you know, sometimes I didn't get that all the time. You know, I was just a young, naive person trying to navigate medical school and, you know, a family that didn't know what medical school was. And, you know, I was just doing it. And so now that I can be able to provide some sort of guidance and advice for others, it's amazing. It's an amazing feeling. It's why I did it to begin with. So, that keeps me going. My patients and residents and students.
Well, it's been such a privilege and so interesting to talk to you today about, you know, what inspires you, your role models for Women's History Month, and of course, reproductive care, which is a topic we don't talk about enough. And, you know, if it takes Women's History Month for us to really put a finer point on it and discuss it, then, you know, we'll take it. But as you said earlier with Black History Month, it's Women's History Month all year round too.
Exactly. Yes.
Is there anything that we didn't touch on that you want to share with listeners to the USC podcast?
No, I just want to share that, you know, I want to acknowledge that, you know, KEK and USC, you know, we have so many resources, so much support, so much philanthropic support, investment in research. We have a lot of things going for us. And I really hope that we all can come together and really truly become leaders for providing care for women's health and underserved populations, women of color, LGBTQ. Like, I really want KEK to really step up and prioritize women's health because it's important. It's not happening. And I really feel that KEK can be a leader in that movement. So I urge everyone to come together and understand, figure out how can we as an institution, you know, help to mitigate bias, microaggressions, ensure that our patients are getting equitable care. How do we do that? And how are we going to do that and lead the way for other institutions to follow? So I really hope that message goes out to everyone listening, because we all have the power to do that. And it'll be just very powerful to see us come together and do that as a group. So
Great. Well, we've been talking today with Nicole Mitchell Chadwick. She's an assistant professor of clinical obstetrics and gynecology at the Keck School of Medicine of USC. She's director of OBGYN Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion. And she's a member of GEMS, which is an organization at the Keck School of Medicine that talks about gender equity in medicine. And you're an implicit bias trainer for GEMS. Mm-hmm. You're also a member of the Keck Executive Steering Committee for DEI. So you have a lot of hats, and I really appreciate you taking the time to speak to me today, because I know you're a very busy person. And boy, I wish that you were my doctor.
I can be your doctor. But no, I thank you for allowing this platform for leaders, women leaders, just, you know, really be able to share our voices and our experiences. And I hope that it was inspiring for those listening, and that I look forward to collaborating with anyone who listens to this and wants to make this happen. So thank you so much for this invitation.
Thanks for listening. Subscribe to our podcast and follow us on Facebook.